Every new programmer goes through the same journey. They start with copy-pasting other people's code and reach this place I call Mount Delusion, where they start believing that they know everything just because they could follow along with a video tutorial. Then, they start checking their emails regularly, hoping to receive a job offer from Google at any moment. When that doesn't happen, the clouds of self-doubt take over and they fall into the death valley where many software engineering dreams rest in peace. But those who choose to persevere enter the slope of enlightenment where they start seeing constant improvement in their coding skills. In the end, they achieve the glamorous life of a software engineer, where a day in their life looks more like a food porn than an actual job. I was lucky enough to reach this stage, as you can see from my LinkedIn. This entire journey is not unique to programming and has this very fancy name that I cannot pronounce. Anyway, in this video, I'll help you get past the death valley by becoming a better programmer in just 8 minutes. The man who does not read has no advantage over the man who cannot read. Mark Twain said this in the context of reading books, but it is true about programming as well. If you look closely at a programmer's daily life, you will see that a programmer spends more time reading code than actually writing it. In fact, I have read 10 times more code than I have written while working at Google. When a new bug gets assigned to you, the first thing you have to do is to find out the root cause. And for a codebase as big as Google's, this means digging through thousands of lines of code to figure out the exact code which is causing the issue. So learning how to read code fast is essential to becoming a good software engineer. Not only that, when you are a beginner, reading code written by people who have been doing it for years will help you improve your own code. If I have seen further, it is by standing on the shoulder of the giants. Sir Isaac Newton wrote this in his letter to a fellow scientist in 1675. There are a total of 28 million public repositories on GitHub, and some of them have code written by engineers who work for giants like Facebook and Google. For example, React, which is a very popular front-end library developed by Facebook, is open source and available for anyone to read. Or BERT, which is a very popular natural language processing model developed by Google, is also one click away. If taking inspiration from others helps Sir Isaac Newton, it can help you as well. You might not discover the law of gravity, but your code might start compiling in less number of attempts. When you start reading a lot of code, you will realize that all good code follows some basic design principles. And that's not unique to programming. Let's do an exercise to understand this. I want you to pause this video right now and imagine your favorite movie of all time. More often than not, the beginning of this movie would have an intriguing hook by using action or suspense. The middle would have character development and is slower than the beginning. The end is again a banger with a lot of animation and drama. That's because all good movies follow this beginning, middle, and end design principle. Similarly, good code also follows some basic design principles. For example, your code should follow the KISS principle. No, I'm not talking about that KISS. KISS here stands for Keep It Simple, Stupid. This principle tells us to avoid any unnecessary complexity and go for a simpler solution when possible. Another design principle is called DRY, which means don't repeat yourself. DRY principle states that one piece of code should occur only once. So if you find yourself constantly checking whether a number is an even number, abstract that check away by writing a dedicated function for it. That way, if somehow the math changes in the future and you want to update this logic, you only have to make this change at one place. My favorite principle, and the one I see violated the most often, is called separation of concerns. Imagine you call an API in your web app, and then you want to parse the response in a certain fashion. Calling the API and parsing the response are two different concerns and should be written separately. There are many other design principles that I didn't cover in this video. I will link an article to these principles in the description. This article and the three other resources that I will share with you later in this video are all free, so do check them out. These design principles can help you structure your code, but you still need to know how to store and retrieve your data. And that's where data structures come in. I know that for many of you, the moment I say data structures, your mind is racing with thoughts like topological sort or Dijkstra's algorithm. We all have been burned by coding interviews at some point in our life. I get that. But that's not what I'm talking about here. In fact, I did not even mention the word algorithms. I'm just talking about learning basic data structures like arrays, hash maps, stacks, or queues here. In one of my previous jobs, I came across this code review where one of my colleagues was storing some numbers in an array and then iterating through the array to find out if a particular number was there in the array or not. Is an array the right choice here? What data structure should he use instead? If you know the answer to these basic problems, that's all you need to know to become a better programmer in the beginning. If you want to have a basic high-level understanding of 8 commonly used data structures, I will link this article in the description. If you want to have a deeper understanding of data structures, but don't want to spend too much time on algorithms, your options are very limited. To help you, I found this course on Coursera that teaches data structures without going too deep into any advanced algorithms. You can check it out from the link down below. Another way to level up your skills as a programmer is to start reading a lot of documentation. Let me show you what most people do when they encounter an error while coding. They copy-paste the error in the Google search, and then they just copy-paste the solution from the top result on Stack Overflow to fix the issue. This might solve the problem for the time being, but it doesn't really help you learn anything new. Instead of just blindly copy-pasting, you should read more and try to understand why the solution actually works. And this is where the documentation can really help you. By reading documentation, you will develop a deeper understanding of why all those cryptic lines of code do what they do. Additionally, you will also discover some new functions that will provide you alternate ways of achieving the same result. The biggest advantage of this, however, is that it will help you wean off the video tutorials and actually become a fully autonomous programmer. And when you walk in for your first job as a software engineer, you will already know how to read documentation and make sense of the code written by other engineers in your company. Because mind you, there will be no video tutorials to help you on the real job. The best way to become a better coder, however, is to build your own projects. And this is where most beginners struggle. Most newbies are great programmers only until that video tutorial is playing on YouTube or Udemy. The moment you remove that, they get confused and don't know how to build something new. And this is where projects come in. Building your own projects does two things for you. One, it gets your resume shortlisted. If you are capable of building working apps, it's a strong signal to the hiring manager that you are a candidate worth talking to. Two, it prepares you for the actual software engineering job. Trust me when I say this, if you build some projects that have a big scope, you will actually have an edge over someone who has a computer science degree but did not build any good projects in college. But the reason most people fail to build projects is because they don't use progressive overloading in the projects they select. Let me explain what I mean by this. Many beginners think that right after they finish a basic course or tutorial on the language they selected, they would build a beautiful website or a cool mobile app. In reality, it takes a long time to get there, and you don't really need to set very high goals in the beginning. Remember that Einstein himself said that compounding is the 8th wonder of the world. And when 1% improvement every day compounds over a year, it can lead to remarkable results. So take small steps in the beginning. Start with an easy project. And then, just progressively overload your projects. Progressive overloading is a technique used by bodybuilders where they gradually increase the weights they lift over a long period of time to build their muscle strength. In a similar way, you can keep increasing the difficulty of your projects over a long period of time to build your coding strength. So keep honing your skills, one project at a time. And if you have some interesting project ideas, leave them in the comments to help our Power community. Knowing all these different techniques to become a better programmer is one thing, but actually implementing them is a totally different ballgame. That's because our brains are easily distracted these days. If you want to learn how I hacked my mind to learn programming, you can watch this video at the top. My name is Sahil, and I'll see you in the next one.